Maybe. But I would love to invite our next speaker on stage, which is Nikita Prokopov, who is returning. He's been here before at ReactiveConf. He's going to talk about connecting the server and the client together. Nikita, please come on stage. The moment of truth.
Yeah, it's basically me, yeah.
Fantastic.
Hi, everyone. Okay. My name is Nikita, and I will be talking today about reactive web applications, right? Specifically about that kind of applications that requires collaboration, basically collaborative web applications. And is it a clicker, right? Should it work?
Did you try turning it on? Does it work?
No, it's not me.
It's not you.
No,
it's us, I know.
Sure.
So close to getting it right. Yeah.
We almost started it. So my talk basically pretty pictures and some content, but pictures are definitely better than the content, so get ready for it.
So we have a solution. It is voice command. That's the big hype.
Okay. So let's try it. Yeah.
Yes.
So So the idea I will be talking about collaborative web applications. So this sort of application when you multiple people get into the same document, work together in real time, see each other's actions. So can you click a couple of times forward, like next, next, next? Okay. Yeah. Next. 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 Yeah, that's it. So, and the question becomes, how hard is it to write that sort of applications, right? I think it's not an easy question. So I decided that we should turn to science to get the answer to it. So next slide, please. The magazine Cosmopolitan ran a poll asking exactly that question. How hard do you think it is to write collaborative web applications? Next one. So 83% just didn't understand the question. Next one. 46% are busy writing mobile games, so they don't think it applies to them, even though it does apply. Next one. 20% think that static typing will save them from any sort of trouble. Next one. 17% think it's actually quite hard. And finally, the next slide. The final 5% think that it's sort of easy, but it actually, it seems easy, but it's actually quite hard. So I was in those 5%. Next slide, please. And I think that, basically the idea is, if you're writing a web application that operates something, doing something non-trivial over the network, so basically getting something working, initial version is pretty easy, right? So it's easy to get that. But as long as you start caring about consistency, reliability, basically getting things right, not losing users' data, it becomes unproportionally hard. So it's much more harder than it seems to be. In my talk, basically, we are going to explore why it seems so hard, why it is so hard, and how to deal with it. So basically, let's pretend for the next 30 minutes that we care about consistency, reliability, and such thing, and see what we can do about it. So next slide, please. Okay, I will be giving an example. Okay, so I decided to give an example of the simplest application possible. The simplest application is just counter. It has just one button and a number. You click a button, number goes up. I think it's the simplest thing you can do. It's collaborative, so everyone is clicking the same button, basically. Next slide, please. So just go to that URL. It's also in the header there, and there's counter that's, well, increasing very fast. So click it a couple of times, and later in this talk I will run some statistics on that clicks. Next slide, please. Okay. But before we get to that statistics, I will explain how I implemented it, right? So you basically need two things, to transport your data over the network and some data structures, so what are you actually transferring. So transport, next one. Okay, so because this task is very, very simple, so it's really to implement it, right? So the protocol would be really simple, like basically you're sending a message like set value with just value, next slide. And the server will send back something like that, like new value is available, please update your counter. Next slide. And because it's so simple, you would probably use something like very basic tools like XML HTTP request, fetch API. Because you want reactivity, you would use something like WebSockets or server send events, something like that. Maybe you would use GraphQL for that, I don't know. It's really simple, just one value, but I just want to check who would use GraphQL for tasks like that. Raise your hand if you would use GraphQL. Okay, one person, cool. Yeah. Okay. It's certainly overkill, but for real application, you'd probably use something like that. Can you switch to next slide? Cool. Yeah. So, my point is that this API are really, really low level, right? If you choose them as your transport to transport your data, you basically pretend that you work in a laboratory condition. When everything works, that server is always online, your device is always online, every request that you send gets a response in time, and so on and so on. So unfortunately, real world is a little bit messier. Next slide. Unfortunately, in real world, all sorts of things happen. Server might die. Your request might time out, right? You can get a response from different server which has slightly different state of cache or something like that. You will get errors and you have to deal with them. You can get responses in a different order than your request coming and stuff like that. So it's really, really messy. Next slide. We agreed that we pretend that we care about consistency, reliability, and stuff like that, making things right, right? So if you decide to make things right by using low-level APIs like Fetch API, WebSocket, and stuff like that, you have to deal with all sorts of problems that arise, right? So basically, there will be errors, right? So sometimes server will respond with an error, so you have to deal with it. And this already is a problem, right? How do you deal with error? Do you retry? How often do you retry? How many times do you retry? At which point you understand that you don't have to retry anymore and stuff like that. It's not an easy to answer that correctly or for everyone. Because you will have WebSocket connection, you will have to manage state. And managing state is not an easy task as well. Managing networking state or state of a connection is much more harder than that, right? Connections are hard to open, hard to close. Connection sometimes wouldn't notify you that it died. It just might suddenly stop working without informing you about it and stuff like that. So you have to run heartbeats. If you're running subscriptions is something that happens inside that connection. Like I now want to get updates on that field. So that's a command you send over the connection, and it's another state, right? When you start it, when you stop it. If you do initial fetch and then start a subscription, there is a small window in between when something might have happened. It's not likely to happen, but it might happen in between, right? So you have to check for those sort of things, or race conditions, responses coming in different order, restoring connection stuff, and stuff like that. It's basically overwhelming. Next slide. So my answer to that is that you just should stop thinking in terms of operations. You should not call it data fetching, right? Data fetch is a bad way to think about data synchronization. You should think about it as a data synchronization. Next slide. And this is a process. So it's basically something that not happens once. It's a process that spans over time, right? So you basically, it's basically happens multiple times. You get updates all the time, right? You get updates on your data. You have retries and so on. So it's something that's just going on and on and on. And you have to, you need to start to think about this as a process rather than a single operation, and everything becomes much easier. Next slide. So yeah, the easiest way to work with that and to think about it is actually to let two storages talk to each other, right? So they have all the information actually to make things right. I haven't mentioned it yet, but basically to do the proper data synchronization, the data, just data isn't enough. You need to track metadata on the data, like when the versions and timestamps of data and stuff like that. And storages can do that. You probably can't or want wouldn't want it, right? So basically just let them talk to each other. It will become much easier. Next slide, and next, and next, and next. Yeah. Hey, one more. Okay, cool. So basically, yeah, stop thinking about operations, right? Start thinking in subscriptions. It's a declarative way, like basically you're saying, I want that data in my browser, just get it for me, right? And you don't care how many operations it require. You don't care how many requests will happen. It might be just single requests. It might be, I don't know, 100 requests with retries and so on, some content negotiation. It might be cached value and zero requests and so on. You don't actually care. You need just that data. And by doing so, you will operate on a much higher level of abstraction, which is easier for you, of course. And the storage that will do that for you will have much more freedom to do this properly and more efficiently than you ever would be able to do by hand. Basically, yeah, it's a win-win situation. Okay, next slide. And most of the storages that are out there are actually doing that, right? So if you get the storage can usually sync with a server. I'm not sure about the quality of the implementation, but architecturally, conceptually, they're at right level of abstraction. And even if they're not doing the perfect job, they can be fixed. But just what's important is that you declare your intention as a subscription in a declarative way, and the implementations take care of the rest. Next slide. Cool. So the second part of our journey to implement the simple counter is to use proper data structures. So a little bit of philosophy here. Can you switch to the next slide? OK, so a little bit of philosophy. When we switched from single machine programming to multiple machine programming, like network programming, it's a similar to a switch of from Newton's laws of physics into relativity theory, right? So basically, everything is there is no single answer to questions anymore. So data is relative, time is relative, and stuff like that. It's true for relativity theory. It's also true for network programming. The second similarity is that the only constant, the only rule that you can rely on in relativity theory is that in any frame of reference, if there is a causality connection, if something caused something else to happen, it will be it will hold true in any system, in any frame of reference, basically, right? And this is also true for network programming. The only thing you can count on is something caused something else to happen. It will always be in that order. If two things are independent, all bets are off. So yeah, data in network is subjective or relative or something like that. Next slide. And basically, and one more. Right. Next slide, please. And the show. Next. Yeah. Okay. So I have this animations that I have to click in time, but it's hard to synchronize over the air. So basically, yeah, in our example of a counter, so counter is that value, two users, two devices fetched that value, one of them clicked twice, other one clicked just once, right? And now we have three machines, each one holding different values. There are 25, 26, 27, right? Which one is more true? Actually, all of them are true, right? There is no one single answer to that question anymore. All of these values are true, they are correct. Next slide. So time is relative as well. Next slide. And in that example, who of those users clicked first? We can't know that. It's actually not that important. There's no way to know who clicked first. So time is opaque from them. It doesn't really matter actually who clicked first. What matters is who get to the server first, right? And unfortunately, this property is out of control. Nobody controls that situation in this setup. Next slide. Yeah, and this is what I was preparing for is that leads to conflicts, right? Because we have all these competing processes happening at the same time, because it is like concurrently editing some data, and data is slightly stale. It's not perfectly actual at machines, right? There's a situation for conflicts. Next slide. Okay, yeah, so basically in that situation, whoever came to server first would lose its updates. Whoever comes second would actually be able to store his updates. But in that situation, it's still a conflict. No matter who comes first, the value should be 28, right? Because the button was clicked three times, the value should be 28. But unfortunately, it's not whatever happens. So we have a problem. We have a problem here, and we have to deal with that. We have to find a way to deal with it. Next slide. Cool. Wow. Okay. forget about it. So this is a very simple thing, okay, and it's implemented on top of Firebase. Somebody hacked it already. Okay, fine. Cool. Yeah. But pretend it makes sense. So somebody has much more conflicts than there's the amount of clicks. Okay. So yeah. So basically, the top counter should show you the value, how many button was clicked with conflicts. The next we see how many times there was a setback when somebody overrides somebody else's updates. The biggest setback is a very large number. Somebody basically resets the counter to 6 to 1. And the bottom ones, I hope it's slightly correct. It's harder to mess it up, but probably it's messed up as well. So it's it's compare and set counter, and it's supposed to be the real amount of clicks that happened. I hope it's something like that. Okay, next one. Whatever. Keep track of everything. But I'm proud of you guys being able to hack it that easily. Yeah, getting Firebase ID from the page source. Yeah, you're great. Keep track of everything. So basically, the way to deal with that, to live with this relative world where everything is like changing all the time, is relative to everyone. It's basically to keep track of everything, right? Next slide. So basically, when you send something over the network, send some, I don't know, operation data, whatever piece of data, assign an ID to it, assign a version to it, or something like that, annotate that data with more information so you know where it comes from, where it's going to, who produced it, is it still actual, is it maybe stale already, or something like that. So next slide. You can use that for checks, like compare and set checks, like here. Basically what it does, it's a way to avoid conflicts. It's not a way to avoid conflicts, it's a way to detect conflicts, right? You can know if something is off. If you're you're sending it to server, basically, the last value that I saw is that. If it's still the last value that you have, please apply this operation. If not, just abort the operation, right? And basically, this is the correct way to update your sources. This is how this last counter was working. Next slide. Never trust clock. So basically, the idea here, I don't know if this is a formal thing or not, like can you prove that or not, but the end result is that in a distributed system, a network system, you can't have a reliable source of time. It's basically not possible, right? Whatever you think, you can think of, no matter how smart you are, there will always be situation when it's wrong. And so just don't rely on it, just forget about it. Next slide. Cool. So these graphs I'll explain what they show. So basically, this is I was measuring the time on your phones when you're sending the updates, and I was comparing that with the server time, right? So this graph shows the distribution of time difference between your device and the server time. The top one, well, basically it shows that most of you are within, I don't know, maybe 20 seconds of server time or something like that. 610 users are within 50 or 60 seconds of server time. So basically, it's 60, like a minute of time difference between you and the server, right? And some crazy amount of people is basically 10 minutes behind the server time. The bottom graph is what I called a corrected clock or skewed clock. It's a utility in Firebase that tries to correct your machine's time by using like ping to the server and server time. So it's basically not relying on your clock, but relying on network time and server time, right? But you can see that still it's way, way off. It's quite similar, and it's not doing a great job at fixing your time. So basically, at least this graph comes as I expected it, right? So at least it shows proves some of my points. So I'm happy at least some of interactivity worked. Next slide, please. Yeah, and next comes some just bits of advice how to live in this crazy world of ever-changing data and synchronizing everything with everything. So normalize your data. Basically, just keep one version of everything on your client, because if you keep multiple versions of your data, you would probably forget to update one of them. Like you know, in GraphQL you can have different branches, but they can, in the end, they can fetch the same like user data or something like that. Just keep it in one place, normalize it, assign ID and stuff like that, so that you don't end up having conflicts inside your client storage, and you don't do like crazy things with it. Next one, please. Use small atomic updates. So basically, don't send the whole document if you need to update just one field. Update operation with just one field, because it makes conflicts less probable, right? If you're updating just one field instead of the whole document, it's much less likely to introduce a conflict. Next one. Also keep track of the updates you are sending as well. So just don't annotate just data, annotate operations as well, because like you want to know if you're sending the same operation twice. You want to know if you have lost some operations and you need to retry them and stuff like that. You have to keep track of them as well. So yeah, basically assign IDs, versions, and stuff like that. Next one. Keep reactive. At this point, I just have to explain. So when I was drawing, like for the first half and something of the presentation, I had time to think of best metaphor for the picture. From now on, it's just some random pictures. Don't think too hard about them, right? So pictures are not related very close to the content. Okay, but anyways, keep reactive. So being reactive at Reactive Conference, of course, means that you have sort of actual data all the time, right? So you have not perfect, but close to perfect data, and it's less probable to run into conflict. Next slide. There is also a social aspect to it. So basically, if you're seeing other person working with you in the same document, you would probably don't want to mess with the area he's working in, and you will either wait for him to finish or work on the other part of the document. So basically, just by displaying your fellow colleagues in the same document helps you avoid some situations where conflict might happen. Next one. Yeah, this pictures are just pictures, okay? Don't get hyped over offline. So basically, offline first, it's a good thing, but I doubt you will be able for applications of any significant complexity, I doubt you will be able to actually implement the offline mode right. Next one. And what I mean by that means that basically by working offline without like internet connection, you are constantly accumulating conflict. You're making more and more conflicts as you work, right? And when you get back online, you basically have to synchronize somehow with the server, but you realize that you have, I don't know, 700 conflicts. And you don't want to show a message like this to a user. Like, you don't want to say, would you like to resolve 700 conflicts, right? Nobody would like to resolve 700 conflicts. So basically, you can show that, OK? So you have only two options. You either override the data on a server, basically destroying other people's data silently, or you drop the update that this person made. And the both options kind of suck. So if you can avoid that, it's best to keep online and inform users in time that they're making some conflict changes before there are like 700 of them. Next one. Sometimes it is possible, right? For simple stuff like Facebook likes, I don't know, writing Facebook comments or something like that, it's possible to actually implement them conflict-free. And if you can do that, of course, do that, go ahead. Offline is cool, is great, but for more complex stuff like collaborative editing of something, like text or, I don't know, pictures or something like that, it's not possible when you're actually working at the same piece of content. It's usually not possible, so just forget about it. It's fine. Online is fine. Probably your users will be fine as well. Next one. Yeah, so it's basically all I got. Just to sum it up, reiterate a little bit. Next one. So you're implementing collaborative web application. You need some way of transport. You want your transport to be declarative. You want it to be at high level of abstraction. You want it to be reactive as well. You want to get updates in real time and so on. Next one. For your data structures, you want them to be annotated. You want to keep track of things. You want to assign versions or IDs or something to data you send over network so you can figure out where it comes from, when was it produced, and stuff like that. And it doesn't change. When you receive it, you don't change it. You just keep it with all the metadata. That metadata helps you make sense of the data that you have. Next one. Offline mode, if you can figure that out, go ahead. But the chances are you probably wouldn't be able to unless you're doing something really simple. So next one, no offline for you. Next one. So this is all I got. Good luck implementing collaborative web applications. And thanks for your attention.
Nikita, thank you so much. But before I let you go off stage, we have 5 minutes, which are the only 5 minutes before everybody's waiting for lunch.
Yeah, of course.
So the number one question on Slido is from a hungry developer. And we're going to go through a couple of them, OK?
OK, sure, yeah.
So the question number one, are GraphQL subscriptions ready to be used on production for data sync? Any limitations?
I have no idea, frankly. So I know they exist. Apollo implements them, I think, but no idea how good are they.
So the next one, are suggesting the use of streams for subscribing to data changes? If so, how to manage in mobile environments where streams are very expensive and discouraged?
Okay, so I have no idea why do you think streams are expensive, like getting updates from a server are expensive. Maybe just I don't know what they're talking about. So from my standpoint, it's not that expensive. Basically, you get new values, but you just write the old values. I don't see where expense comes from, so no idea.
The next one is from David. Can you please teach me to make these awesome slides as well?
Yeah, sure. So basically, you take iPad, you take a pencil, and just draw it. Yeah. You take some picture from the internet, you make a contour for it, and remove the picture, something like that, yeah. You're welcome. Yeah, I should probably start selling courses for drawing slides or something.
You should. You definitely should.
Yeah. But thank you. Yeah, thank you.
The next question is, what about allowing multiple values, CFRD, and resolving at app level with business rules?
Yeah, so I'm not sure what CFRD comes from. Maybe it's CRDT, maybe not. I don't know. So allowing multiple values is a way to go. I think, I had other version of that presentation where I'm talking about, yeah, that the conflicts are actually not a technical problem, but a problem with at the business domain level, right? So you have to decide what to do with them. If two users are doing something conflicting, it's actually depending on what exactly are they doing, what the nature of the data they are changing. And you should come from there and decide what to do with it. So basically, yeah, it's great if you can allow yourself to write the code that at application level actually sees these multiple values coming from different users and makes an informed decision on how to deal with them. It's the best way to go. It's just not very convenient. But if you can do that, of course, go ahead. It's the best way, I think.
We have time for one more question.
Cool. Yeah,
why don't you simply use a FIFO queue system? First in, first out. I know that from
why
school.
Why don't you simply use a FIFO queue system?
Yeah.
Well, the answer is probably is because, there are two ways to do that. If you hope for like a single queue of updates on a server, you have to wait for server to confirm every action you do, and this is very slow and not convenient. If you implement a queue on each client, it will be different queues, right? So one user appends some events, other user appends different events, and now you have like two different queues which you have to merge. And basically, the process of merging them, deciding what goes first and what goes after it, it's basically resolving conflicts. So there is no way around it.
Nikita, thank you very much.
Yeah,
please
sure.
Give a warm welcome, and we'll thank you for Nikita. Thank you.